Good morning, everyone. My name is Colin, and I am here at the Inside Education Calgary office in our studio. And I'm super excited to be hosting the first in our student environmental education series about trees and forests. So you should be able to see my slides up on the screen, and you'll notice that there's a link up there at the top. So if you're joining me from if you're joining me live from Zoom, you can ask questions through Zoom and I'll check them there. If you're joining through YouTube, you can use that link, slides.app.goo.gol/LW9E9, to ask me questions directly through Google. And those will show up in my presentation and I can answer those as well. So feel free if you're watching live to ask questions at any time. Otherwise, I'll take a few pauses here and there to give you some time, and then we'll get on with the show. So first things first, Inside Education, if you're not familiar, we are a natural resource and environment education charity in Alberta. We work all across the province, and normally we love to take students outside to the forest, and we come and visit your classrooms. We host youth conferences, and we even teach teachers on professional development programs. And unfortunately, we can't do most of those things right now, and so we are hosting these weekly sessions so that anybody can join in from kind of wherever, in addition to also visiting classrooms virtually one-on-one. So today, like I mentioned, we're going to be talking about trees and forests. It's the first in our series, and this is one of my favorite topics, so I'm really excited, and let's get into it. So the first thing we're going to do is to imagine ourselves in the forest. Like I said, we love to take you to the forest, but because we can't do that today, I'm going to try and bring the forest to you. And so that's going to require some imagination. And so if you're sitting here watching, I would like you to grab a piece of paper and something to draw with. And what we're going to do is I'm going to play some sounds, and we're going to imagine ourselves sitting in a forest, and I want you to think about all of the things that are going on around you. What do you see? What do you hear? What do you smell? What do you feel? Maybe even what you're tasting, and we're going to draw them. And then we're going to use this to kind of talk about what makes a forest, and I'm going to do it along with you. So I'm going to play the sounds, and we're going to draw for a couple minutes. I'll show you my drawing, and then we'll talk about it. Okay, so maybe finish up what you're drawing, or if you like to continue doodling while I talk, that's okay if it helps you concentrate. But I'm going to show you what I drew. Now, I'm not a great artist, but we'll see what we came up with. So I drew some trees, as you can see. This is my bear. He's chomping on some berries at this bush. I got a little pond with some reeds, a fallen over log with a squirrel, and some birds and the sun. What did you draw? Now, I think that it's important to highlight here that I'm sure most of you drew a tree, but a forest is more than just the trees, right? There's all the other things that make the forest the forest. It's all the living things that are there, like the animals and the plants and the fungus, but also the non-living things, like the soil and the rocks and the water and the sun and the wind. And combined, all of those conditions together make a forest. And so what I would like you to do throughout the rest of this presentation is to think about this forest that's in your head, and think back to that when we're talking about the forest. So now what we're actually going to do is take a bit of a tour of the forests of Alberta, because there's lots of different kinds of forests in Alberta, and they're all a little bit different. And the best way to look at this is to look at something called our natural regions. So you've probably heard about these before. There are six natural regions in the province of Alberta. And a natural region is a way that we categorize the different landscapes of the province. So the different plants and animals that live there and all the non-living and living things, right? So you might know them. And if you do know them, you could even turn your drawing over and write them down on the back if you like. I'll give you a second to do that. Remember, there's six. That's the map of them there. Okay, so here they are. There is the Canadian Shield in yellow, the Boreal Forest in green, the Foothills in blue, Parkland in red, Rocky Mountains in purple, and grasslands in orange. Now, it's actually a fact that 60% of the province is covered in trees and forests, more than half. And the majority of these natural regions are quite heavily forested. In fact, we can find forests in every single one of them. So let's have a look and see what they look like. First, we're going to go to the Canadian Shield. The Canadian Shield is up in the northern part of the province, and it's actually quite different from a lot of the province in that the Canadian Shield is referenced to the rocks that make up a big portion of northern Canada and all the way out east. And so we just get a little bit of it here in Alberta. It's very rocky and very wet. There's lots of bogs and wetland, different other kinds of wetlands. There's even sand dunes, which is really cool. But the trees, they do like to hang on to the places where they can. And so we do find forests in the Canadian Shield. Now, this is a great time to review some vocabulary, because there are two different categories of trees that we usually use to identify them. So we have trees that look like the ones on the right, and we have trees that look like the ones on the left. And so the ones on the left grow these things, which are cones. And so they are coniferous trees. You can remember that because they're coniferous. And the trees on the left, they are trees that have leaves that fall off. And so they're deciduous. The word deciduous refers to the fact that they lose their leaves. In fact, if you have baby teeth, and all people have baby teeth when they're young, and those teeth fall out, those are also technically called deciduous teeth. So deciduous trees, you can remember that they lose their leaves because they decide to have leaves or not. Now, this isn't always the easiest way to categorize trees because, in fact, one of the trees on the slides here is both coniferous and deciduous. At the bottom right, you see some tiny little clusters of bright green needles and a little cone. That is from a larch tree. And larch trees are coniferous trees. They have cones, but their needles fall off every year. So they're a little bit of both. So in the Canadian Shield, most of our trees are coniferous trees. And some of the species names are species like black spruce, which like to live in wet areas, and jack pine. There are some deciduous trees, but they're pretty far and few between. All right, next we're going to visit the boreal forest. So as you can imagine, the boreal forest is basically entirely covered in forest. And there's a little picture of what it might look like somewhere in the boreal forest. Now, the boreal forest is a mixed forest, meaning that there are both coniferous and deciduous trees, but it's still largely dominated by those coniferous trees. And there are similar species to the Canadian Shield, actually. So we find black spruce because they like to live in the wet areas, the boggy areas of the boreal forest. And we also find jack pine. But we also see more deciduous trees like aspen, poplar, and birch trees. So birch and aspen are both white trees. And birch, it can be identified from aspen because it has papery, peely bark. But if you see a birch tree, I don't recommend peeling that bark off because it can harm the tree. So next, we're going to visit the foothills. So the foothills are those rolling hills at the base of the Rocky Mountains. And again, they're actually really heavily forested. There are lots and lots of trees in the foothills. And now the foothills is kind of a continuation of the boreal forest as it goes higher up in elevation. And so it's very similar. We see a lot of mixed forest, and it's less dominated by coniferous trees. It's more of a truly mixed forest now. But we start to see some different species, actually. So instead of black spruce, like we see in the wet boreal forest, up in the foothills, you see more white spruce, its cousin that likes drier ground. And instead of jack pine, we see lodgepole pine, which is actually the provincial tree of Alberta. The deciduous trees that we find here are more aspens and balsam poplars. Okay, moving south from the boreal forest and the foothills, we get this weird, interesting, mixed region where it's kind of the edge of the forest and the start of the grasslands. And so it's called a parkland because of the different patches of forest that we find. And the forests that we find in the parkland are almost entirely deciduous. In fact, most of the trees are actually aspen poplar trees. Aspen trees, like I said before, are other trees with white bark, but their white bark is smooth and powdery, especially when they're young. And that powder is actually a fungus that grows on the tree and helps the tree protect itself from the sun. It's basically a sunscreen. And you could even use it for a sunscreen yourself. It's just not as strong as the sunscreen you would buy at a grocery store or a pharmacy. Okay, let's look at the Rocky Mountains because this is a super interesting one. So the Rocky Mountains are where we start to see mountains shoot out of the ground and they get really high. And so the forests and the plants and animals that live there changes a lot with elevation. So down low, it's very much like the foothills. It's the same. There's lots of mixed forests and they are have white spruce and lodgepole pine and aspen poplars. But the higher up you go, the less and less deciduous trees there are. Because coniferous trees are specifically very good at living in cold temperatures with short growing seasons. And that's what it's like up high in the mountains. And so as you go higher, you start to see new species of trees that you don't find anywhere else. We find more fir trees, which are kind of like soft, friendly coniferous trees. A lot of them are times they're used for Christmas trees. We also see some endangered species like whitebark and limber pine. They're both endangered because they are impacted by mountain pine beetle and blister rust, which is a fungus. And so, actually, unfortunately, changing climate has led to beetle populations and fungus that is usually kept in check by cold to move further north. These trees are super interesting because they can live a really long time. The oldest one in the province is actually 3,000 years old. And our very last natural region is the grasslands. Now, the grasslands don't have a whole lot of forest, as you can imagine, because they're called grasslands, but we do actually still find some forests around the wet areas of the province. We see it in river valleys. So if you live in Calgary, we're kind of on the edge of the grasslands, and down by the river, there's lots of big poplar trees. And same if you go further east and south in Lethbridge, in the river valley, you will find some forests, and it's all deciduous trees. And we also see other species of poplars that are more common further east, like black cottonwood. Okay, so we have these forests all over the province, but it's really important to recognize that while the forest is a natural place that does all kinds of things on its own, we also take resources from the forest. Particularly, we take wood from the forest. And so we take trees and we create products from them. And so we're going to have a look here at where are the forests in Alberta actually harvested for wood products. So in behind the natural region map, there is now another map of Alberta that shows forest management areas. So forest management areas are large sections of land where forestry companies are allowed to harvest. Interestingly, and it's not entirely a coincidence, 60% of our province is covered in trees, and 60% of our province is what's called public or crown land. So public or crown land is land that's owned by all of us who live in Alberta together. And so in the case of the forests that grow on those lands, we allow the forestry companies to manage that land for us. And that means that they get to cut some trees down, but they also have to consider all of the other things that are happening in the forest. Now, we might notice that the majority of these FMAs or forest management areas are in the foothills and boreal forest natural region. Why is that? Well, the main reason is that in forestry, the main trees that we're interested in are those coniferous trees. So the pine, fir, and spruce trees. And so in the foothills and the boreal forest, that's where we find most of those trees. Now, we also have coniferous trees in the Rocky Mountains and in the Canadian Shield. But in those natural regions, we have a lot more protected areas. So we have provincial and national parks. And so we've decided that that land is more valuable to be left on its own and valuable for recreation and conservation instead of for harvesting. And so there's not very many forestry operations there. Okay, now is a great time if you have any questions in your class or if you're watching individually, you can submit it through that slides Google link or through Zoom. I'll pause for just a moment to see if anyone submits any questions. And if not, I will move on to the next part. Okay, I'm not seeing any questions, so we're gonna move on. Oh, wait, I see one. Why are they more interested in coniferous instead of deciduous trees? Great question. So there's lots of different factors that go into that. One is that coniferous trees are oftentimes referred to as softwood trees. And deciduous trees are hardwood trees. Now, neither softwood or hardwood is a better type of wood. They just have better applications for different things. So softwoods are less dense, they're not as heavy, they're easier to work with, and they're flexible. Whereas hardwood trees are very heavy, dense, and they're very strong. They're very useful for certain things. Like if you wanted to make a really strong door, you could use a hardwood tree. But in terms of when we want to build structures that are quick and easy to build, we can use softer woods that are less heavy, like pine, spruce, or fir, to build the lumber that we make those things out of. Now, deciduous trees in Alberta also are not particularly hard. We have the poplar trees of Alberta are actually, they are hardwood trees, but they are really susceptible to rot. So they decay very quickly. They grow kind of very quickly and don't have very good quality wood in them. Whereas most of the coniferous trees, they grow straight and tall and have good straight wood in it. The deciduous trees are still used. In fact, for example, in the northern boreal forest in the Alberta Pacific Forest Industries forest management area, they use a lot of aspens to create pulp for paper, which we'll talk about in just a second. Another question is there anything being done to protect the endangered trees? And yes, there is. So a lot of the endangered trees are living, like I said, in the Rocky Mountains natural region. And the majority of that, those natural regions, and the majority of the habitat that these trees live in are actually in our national parks. So Banff and Jasper, and also Waterton have populations of these endangered trees. There's also a lot of work being done to try and help protect them from the things that affect them. So protect them, help them adapt to fungus like blister rot or blister rust, and also from mountain pine beetles. So there's lots of research being done, and they are because they're an endangered species, you aren't allowed to go and cut them down or harm them, for sure. Okay, so if you have more questions, you can keep submitting them while I go. I will address them at certain points, and I'll also pause again later to give you an opportunity. Okay, so going back to what we make from the forest, I mentioned pulp. And so pulp is something that we make into paper. And that's one of the main products that we make out of trees here in Alberta. We also make lumber. So lumber, as I was also talking about that, is something that we use to build structures out of. So we build our homes, we build different buildings. We all can also make furniture and various other things out of it. Now, there are all kinds of other things that come from the forest as well. So we're going to have a look at what those things might be. So I'm going to put some images up on the screen, and I want you to think, does this item come from the forest or not? And then I will tell you. So first up, we have some berries. Maybe these are blueberries. So do you think that comes from the forest? Now, a lot of the berries that you find at the grocery store are in fact harvested from farms, right? But there are a lot of native berries that grow in Alberta. So for example, blueberries can be found all over the foothills and the boreal forest. Wild blueberries are very delicious. And if you can go out in the forest in the fall and you can find and identify wild blueberries, they're really awesome to pick right from the forest. And so berries do come from the forest. Okay, next up, how about some red meat? Do we think meat comes from the forest? So meat can come from the forest. It depends on what kind of meat you're eating, right? So if it's red meat, maybe it's beef. And so beef comes from cows, right? Now cows oftentimes will grow up on ranches and they'll be finished on feedlots and then they'll end up at the grocery store. But there are also lots of cows in Alberta who live in the forest. Did you know that? So because a lot of forest is what's called public land, we also allow grazing leases on public land. And so what that means is farmers can take their cattle for the summer out to the forest and let them roam and eat whatever they can find while they're out there. And so they leave them out there for a little while, they let them eat and graze on all of the things that are just growing naturally. And then at the end of the summer, they go and collect the cattle and bring them back to their farm. And so if you're eating beef, there is a good chance that some of your beef actually grew and was living in the forest at one point, which is pretty cool. Now, of course, there are other wild animals that we harvest from the forest as well. People love to hunt. We're getting up to hunting season pretty shortly. And so deer and moose are really common animals that are hunted from the forest for their meat. Okay, next up, this one's a bit different. Car tires. Do you think car tires come from the forest? So rubber is what car tires are made out of. And there are two kinds of rubber. Well, that's being very general, but we'll call it two kinds of rubber. There's natural rubber and synthetic rubber. So natural rubber actually comes from a tree. But we don't have any rubber trees here in Alberta. They grow in rainforested areas, so kind of near the equator. So down in South America and in the Pacific, we find rubber trees. So they do actually, rubber does come from a forest, but not Alberta forests. Synthetic rubber or man-made rubber is actually made from oil. And oil is found, as we know, underground in lots of places in Alberta. So we see oil in the southern of Alberta that's pumped up with pump jacks and wells. But there's also lots of oil in northern Alberta in our oil sands. And the oil sands are majorly found in the boreal forest. So even though the oil isn't coming from the forest itself, it comes from under the forest. And so it's actually connected to your forest. Very last one, bubblegum. Do you think bubblegum comes from the forest? Okay, so one thing that's super interesting is that the people who have been living in North America for thousands of years, Alberta's First Nations people sometimes they even still do chew on sap from spruce trees to kind of help clean your teeth and like a bubble gum. And so you could make gum from tree sap. But there's also modern gum that you might go buy at a grocery store. And inside of that gum, there are all kinds of different ingredients. And one of those ingredients that you find pretty commonly actually comes from trees. So if you look at your gum and you see cellulose or xylitol, both of those chemicals are chemicals that are brought from trees and the chemicals that grow inside of trees, which is pretty cool. Okay, now we're going to have a quick look at how we actually go from the forest to the pages of a book. So we have a forest here, a forest that looks like many different forests that we might find in Alberta. And of course we need to go out and harvest those trees. Now, once upon a time, that would have been done by hand with big saws and axes. But nowadays it's all done by machine. So there's a machine called a feller buncher. It looks like an excavator with a digging claw on the front. But instead of the claw for digging, it's got a claw for grabbing with a saw blade at the bottom. And it'll go up to a tree and cut them off at the bottom and collect a couple and then lay them down in the forest. They'll be dragged out of the forest and processed, removing all the branches and loaded up onto a logging truck, which if you've driven around forested areas of Alberta, you've probably seen them before. Then they get to a mill. So a mill is a building or a facility that processes wood. So if they make lumber, it would be a lumber mill. In this case, we're going to look at a pulp mill. A pulp mill, when the woods arrive, will debark the logs. So it'll break all of the bark off because the bark doesn't make very good paper. And then the wood will be chipped up into tiny little pieces. And then that wood will be washed with water and a bunch of different chemicals to help break down some of the more challenging and difficult components of the wood to leave behind the stuff that makes great paper. And so it'll also be bleached and different things will be added to make it more white and to make it more pure. If we want to have white paper, like the one I drew on that I would put in a printer, there's a lot of processing involved for this. Whereas if you have paper that you might put in a more rustic journal, it won't be as processed. That pulp will then be dried out on screens and made into sheets of paper, which then can be cut up to be put into a book. Now, a cool thing about paper is that all of the fibers are recyclable. And so oftentimes when you buy a book or you rent a book from the library, you can see inside the first couple pages, it will tell you how much of the paper is recycled and how much of it is new. Okay, I'm gonna put this one up, who uses the forest? You guys can think about that. And then this is also another time for you to ask some more questions. And I will see, we have a couple questions from before that I didn't get to. So the first one is, why do trees help with oxygen? So trees are a really big producer of oxygen. Most of the oxygen in the atmosphere comes from different organisms that photosynthesize. So that what that means is they take energy from the sun and they combine water and carbon dioxide together to make sugar. And one of the byproducts, a waste product of that process, is actually oxygen, which is pretty handy for all of us other organisms who need oxygen to breathe. So a lot of oxygen in the atmosphere comes from algae that lives in the ocean, but there's also a lot of oxygen that comes from the forest and from the trees. And so trees are a really big part of contributing fresh oxygen to our atmosphere. Someone asked, do pests eat the inside of a tree? Does a tree just fall down after? That's a really great question. So in the case of mountain pine beetle, they're a bark beetle. And so what that means is they like to eat the living tissue just below the bark. It's called the cambium layer. Now, the cambium layer is also really important for the tree's growth and important to bringing the nutrients from the soil up to their leaves. And so the beetle will eat that layer. And eventually, if they eat enough of it, the layer will no longer be able to grow and won't be able to help the tree bring nutrients up. And so then the tree will die. Now, the beetles themselves, they're not going to eat enough of the tree to make the tree fall over. But once the tree starts to die and the beetles make holes in the tree, now there's holes for fungus to get in the tree. And fungus really likes those long fibers that make a tree strong. And so the fungus will break those fibers down. And so if you ever look inside of a stump or a fallen log, you might notice that the wood looks kind of blocky and broken up. And that's because a fungus has actually gone in and broken up the different chains of fibers in the tree. And when those fibers are broken and not long and strong anymore, then all it takes is a strong wind to blow over the tree and it will actually fall down. Not directly because of the beetle, but because of all the other things that happened after the beetle. Someone asked about more differences, like why are there coniferous and deciduous trees? So we talked about the cones versus not cones and broadleaf versus needle leaves. But there's a main reason that they exist is that they're the two different trees types exist is that they're basically different ways of adapting to changes in weather. So we have seasons here in Alberta, and deciduous trees, their method of handling winter, because you can't photosynthesize, they can't do anything in the winter, their method is to just let their leaves fall off because the leaves are going to freeze. They're really wide and flat, so in the summer they get lots of sun and they can photosynthesize a lot. They grow really quickly. But then during the winter time, they lose all their leaves and they stop growing and they just wait for the summer to come back. Now, coniferous trees, they kind of, instead of taking a lot of energy to regrow their leaves every year, their leaves are needles. They're shorter, or they're not short, not very short, but they're not so wide. They're round or flat or square, and they're very long and skinny, and they are waxy. They're hard. And so the waxy part of the leaves protects them from freezing in the winter. Now, because they're smaller, they don't have as big of a surface area as the deciduous leaves, they don't photosynthesize as fast. They don't grow as fast. But because they can keep their leaves all year long, they have a longer growing season. As long as the ground and the water inside the tree isn't frozen, they can continue to grow, whereas a deciduous tree can't do that. And so they're just two different ways that trees have adapted to winter, basically. Someone asked, do you make money out of trees? Great question. So paper that is used to make money in some parts of the world absolutely comes from trees. So sometimes you hear, money doesn't grow on trees. It doesn't grow on trees, but it does grow inside of trees. Now, Canada's money nowadays is a plastic money, but I don't actually know if that plastic is oil-based plastic or if it's a plant-based plastic. We can actually make plastic out of plants. And so it's possible that we even today still use trees to make Canadian money, but I don't know that for sure. I would recommend that you look it up. Someone else asked what kind of shrubs live in the forest. So one of the shrubs, for example, I mentioned before is blueberries. So blueberries are a shrub. They're a small plant that's woody and has lots of stems and they grow berries. They're really common in the forest. Another really common shrub in the foothills is buffalo berry. So buffalo berry is a shrub that grows bright red, orange, or yellow berries. And they're actually the favorite food of grizzly bears. Grizzly bears love to eat buffalo berries. Okay, I'll answer one more. Someone else asked about if mills make splinters. So when mills are processing logs, there's lots of spinning blades and things chopping up the logs and breaking them apart, and they absolutely make a lot of splinters and dust. And so the mill could potentially be a dangerous place, but they have lots of safety procedures involved, and there's lots of things to put in place to help make sure it is safe. If you ever get a chance to go on a mill tour, you probably will see that there are wood chips kind of all over the place, but they have to make sure that they clean up to make sure that nobody hurts themselves. And so they can be dangerous places, but we do, at a mill, they do their best to make sure that it's safe for everybody who works there. Okay, so next I want you to think about who uses the forest. And so this is a picture we've been looking at it for a little while here. It's a picture from one of our posters called Between the Stands. And on this poster, we see what a modern forest might look like, about what shows all the different people who are using the forest. So I want you to think about who do you see on this poster, and potentially also who else do you know who's using the forest who isn't on the poster. And if you want, you could add them to your drawing. So you could draw them to your drawing, or you could just write their name, write them down next to your drawing to remind yourself who uses the forest. So I'll write down a couple here, and then we'll show some on the slide. Okay, so some of the things you might see on this slide are someone who's skiing on the left-hand side. So people like to have fun and recreate in the forest. There is some wildlife, the bottom left here. There's some livestock. So those are the cows I was talking about. There are lumber mills where we could process the trees into lumber. There's a mine up here in the top right. Maybe it's an oil sands mine. Maybe it's a coal mine. And there's also a forester who is potentially working on either harvesting or regenerating this forest. So what else? Who else uses the forest? What else would you say? I'm sure you all have very different ideas and different thoughts about who uses the forest. Some other ones that I thought of are hikers, so people who are hiking the forest during the summertime as opposed to the wintertime. Oil and gas workers, so there's the mine. And me, I spend a lot of time out in the forest, both for fun and for recreation, but also for work in the normal times. I take people out to the forest to learn and on field trips. And so education can be a part of the forest as well. Okay, so now we're gonna have a look at why else the forest is important. And so we've talked about a couple of different reasons here. Now, let's see, did anyone ask about this? So someone asked about oxygen, right? And so we talked about oxygen, and that's a big reason that forests are important. They provide a lot of oxygen. Someone else asked about the animals that live inside the forest and what do they do for the forest? And so the forest is a really big habitat for wildlife, right? There's all kinds of animals that live in the forest. Now, every animal has its own specific role in the forest. So for example, woodpeckers are an animal that actually kind of both helps and is not so good for trees. They help the trees because they love to eat insects that are inside the tree. And so they'll peck at the bark and they'll rip open some holes and they'll eat the insects that are living inside the tree and harming the tree. Unfortunately, the woodpecker has now just made a big hole in the tree, which makes a space for fungus to get inside. And so then the fungus can start breaking down the tree. Now, the interesting thing is that sometimes those holes will then grow and they'll get bigger and bigger. And then a different animal will come along and use that hole as a nest or as a little home to hide in. And so they're all really connected. Another example is maybe a grizzly bear or a black bear. They really like to eat buffalo berries, like I said. And so black bears and grizzly bears and buffalo berries are really closely connected because the bears help the berries or the shrubs reproduce. They eat the berries. And then if you go out in the late summer out in the forest, you might see lots of like really loose bear poop full of red stuff. And that's usually it's because they've eaten so many buffalo berries, they get kind of an upset tummy, and they spread the seeds that way. And so then the bears have now helped the forest by helping the buffalo berry regrow. Okay, I'm going to keep talking about some other reasons the forests are important. If you have any other questions, please go ahead and submit them, and I will keep moving along. So another reason that forests are important is water. So I think someone had, because I mentioned algae, and algae lives in water. Someone asked if algae in the water comes from trees. The algae doesn't come from the trees, but they are closely related. A long, long, long time ago, algae and trees probably share, or they do share a common ancestor, but we're talking millions and millions and millions of years. Now, trees are important to water because they do a couple different things. One is that trees hold on to soil. Their roots grow into the ground and they hold on to the earth so that it doesn't wash away. And so that helps keep our rivers and lakes clean. But more importantly, they do something called evapotranspiration. So while trees are photosynthesizing, they have to take water from the ground to combine it with carbon dioxide to make sugar. And so while they're doing that, some of the water is lost. So the tree leaves have little little holes in them, basically, which allows the tree to breathe. And we lose water that evaporates out of the leaves that way. And that's important because water in the atmosphere doesn't usually travel very far. It gets picked up from somewhere, usually like an ocean or a big lake, and it goes in the atmosphere and it blows around. And usually it lasts about 100 to 150 kilometers before it falls out of the sky again in the form of rain or snow. Now, in Alberta, we are more than 150 kilometers away from the ocean. And so the water that we get here in the province is actually, it is coming from the ocean eventually, but what it does is it goes out of the ocean through the atmosphere and it falls down on British Columbia. And then trees in British Columbia pick up that water and put it back in the atmosphere, and it can travel further and further and further until eventually it makes it to Alberta. And so trees are a really important part of preventing desertification, so preventing places from turning into deserts. If you cut down all the trees nearby, it'll start to get drier and dustier. Whereas if you plant trees, it will help it to be wet, and there will be more water in the cycle. Recreation is a big part of it. So we talked a lot about all the people who use the forest for fun. And then, of course, industry. And so when we talk about trees being used as a resource, there resources as in Alberta are a really big part of our economy. And so our number one resource industry is oil and gas, and has been for a very long time. But we also have agriculture, especially in southern Alberta, there's lots of agriculture. And then our third biggest resource industry in Alberta is actually forestry. And now one thing that's important to this is that I mentioned a little bit before, is that if we cut down all the trees, we might see an area turn into a desert, right? And so it's a really important part of forestry to make sure that the trees always grow back, because they are a renewable resource. So in order to make sure that the trees continue to grow back and that we have forests for the future, every tree that's cut down has to be replanted. Maybe you have other reasons that you think the forest is important. And so if you have those, or if you really like some of the ones that I showed you, I would say you could go ahead and add those to your drawing as well. Okay, so to wrap this up, I want to talk to you guys about what can you do to conserve natural resources. So trees is a natural resource. What can we do to make sure that there are still trees in the future so that we can continue to make things out of them, but that they can also continue to provide oxygen and habitat for wildlife and protect the water cycle? How do we do that? And so there's lots of different things that everyone can do, and you probably have ideas that you can do as well. So I would encourage you to write them either on the front or the back of your drawing, and then I'll give you some suggestions. So first things first is I have used some paper to make my drawing and write some things on it. And I could, in this case, I used some paper, but maybe I could do a better job of trying to make sure I use less paper. Or when I'm done with this paper, I can turn it over and use the other side to take some notes. And then when I'm finally very done with it and I can't use it anymore, I can recycle it and it can be turned into a different paper product. So those are, that's like your classic three R's, like reduce how much paper you use, reuse it by drawing on the other side. And finally, when you're done with it, you can recycle it. Another important thing is that when you visit the forest, it's really important to be respectful of the things that are there. And so all the plants and animals that are living there are an important part of the forest. And so while you're visiting the forest, making sure that you're staying on the trails, if there are trails, and you're not trampling all the other plants that live there. And if you see any wildlife, to make sure that you're respectful and you give them space to do the things that they need to do to survive. One of my favorite things about conserving natural resources is to tell people why you care about them and why they're important. And so I like to do that through my job here presenting to you, but I hope that you can do that by talking to people that you care about and telling them something cool that you learned today. And then one last suggestion for you, which I think is super important because today is kind of a special day. Today is actually called Take Me Outside Day. And so today is a day where people are encouraged to go outside and learn. And so I think for you to conserve natural resources, you should go spend a little bit of time outside today, maybe get to know a tree in your neighborhood. Okay, we're almost out of time. I'm going to answer any more questions that show up. There's one here that I'll answer. And if I see any more, I'll answer that one as well. So first up, we have a question, do trees have diseases? And they absolutely do. Trees, just like me and you, can get sick. Now, COVID-19, trees can't get COVID-19, I don't think. I'm not a tree biologist, but I doubt it. But they can get other diseases, and diseases can come in the form of fungus, like I said, or other forms. And so trees absolutely can get sick, and there's lots of different diseases that they get. One example is called dwarf mistletoe. So it affects the trees and it causes the tree to grow all misformed and creates these like clusters and clumps of branches that we call witch's brooms. And so that's one way that trees can get sick. So definitely trees can absolutely have diseases. Let me see if I missed any questions or I see any new ones. Okay, I think that's it. I don't see any more questions coming in. So I want to thank you so much for tuning in today and joining me for the first in our student environmental education series. If you want to learn more about different natural resource topics, I recommend you take a look and you can join some of the future ones. I hope you learned something today and I hope you get a chance to go outside. Thanks.